Alida Kinney Starr is an artist and activist originally from Calgary, Alberta, Canada. She is of Mohawk and Italian descent and has been making art professionally for nearly 3 decades. Most well known for her musical talents, Starr is also a filmmaker, an author, and artist skilled in many mediums, beginning as an anti-media and anti-colonial feminist street artist with mad graffiti skills. She was originally signed to Def Jam Records in 1996. Starr has been nominated for Juno Awards, appeared in various films and television as an actor and performer, and has performed with Cirque du Soleil in Las Vegas. She has performed her music live around the world in North America, Europe, and Asia. She has also made a number of school appearances helping children to discover their own musical abilities. She is still working as an artist and activist today. Her most recent album, Feed the Fire, was released in 2018. Her upcoming release is entitled She Walks Upstream. This will be her first ambient sound album, which was the soundtrack for the documentary Edge of the Night, which won Best Canadian Film at Vancouver International Film Festival, the Sun Jury Award at Imagine Native, and is included in the Toronto Film Festival's Top 10 list. Starr was also deeply involved in the recent documentary Play Your Gender, taking a serious look at women in the music industry. We are lucky enough to have asked a few questions to Starr about her life and art. Please talk about your relationship with water.
Okay, so the first question is, talk to you about my relationship to water. Water for me was originally when I was younger, because I have like legs that come up to my rib cage, literally. Like, no. So like I was just legs and arms with like a little tiny short little upper body, and so I was very awkward. And there was a girl in my school who was also very awkward, this half Japanese kid who I'm still friends with, actually. This is in Calgary, Rachel Iwasa. And so we were allowed to sit out from sports, like all sports in school, because we were very bad, so nobody would pick us. We would get picked last, and then the kids wouldn't want us on their teams, blah, blah, blah. So I was so awkward as a child that I just didn't really feel comfortable. But when I was in the water, I felt really free. I felt strong, beautiful, able. I felt like I couldn't injure myself because I wouldn't trip and fall. And so I grew this really like steady relationship with water. And then when I became older as an adult, I always had these rituals with water. For instance, I would like, you know, look at the water, I'd hold it up and like look at it and talk to it like in my mind or out loud, put it in the light, in the sunlight, have it collect energy, all this shit. And when I was a little girl, I used to do that. And then when I was fast forward to being an adult, like in my 20s, and I was in Toronto, because I grew up in Calgary, so I didn't grow up around other Mohawk people. And then I was like in Toronto and I was around other Mohawk people, and I seen these older women do some of the similar rituals that I, like holding their water before and like connecting with it before they drank it. So then I started to be like, oh shit, this is cultural. And then I also always liked the silence of the water, so like, and also the way how there's sort of underwater cities in the water, like the reeds look like trees, and I felt like it was a kind of a parallel universe, and I just felt really safe there. And then now and fast forward now into my lifetime, and I lost my brother in the opioid crisis. He was in Barrie, Ontario. That's the epicenter of the opioid crisis. And so now when he died, I had a friend, my friend Rebecca. She's Mohawk in Toronto. And she was like, you know, you've got to understand he's an ancestor now. And that helped me so much, because I've always had a feeling of like, time being like a forward, moving forward and backwards at the same time. So when she said that to me, I was able to really put it in perspective and be like, okay, he's young, but he's old. But, and so now whenever I do a lot of cold dips now with the ocean and lakes and stuff, and I always feel like I'm connecting with the ancestors, for lack of a better word, and with my brother when I go into the water.
What is your best mental health advice?
My best mental health advice, I would say, is because I grew up since before the internet and before digital culture. And so I would say that it's very important to remember that just because someone sends you a text, it doesn't mean you have to respond. Just because someone sends you an email, it doesn't mean you have to respond. And not all communication is on the same priority wavelength. So for instance, I think that a good mental health practice is learning to respond to the things you need to respond to and letting the other things slide, because in a digital world we are always prodded to communicate, and I don't think we're necessarily always ready. And the other mental health advice that I give to people is working hard at your craft, especially in the arts, provides a lot of stability. And that doesn't mean you need to work all day, and it doesn't mean you need to compete with other people, but it means applying yourself to your craft is great for mental health. And then obviously the other mental health advice that I would give, and let's remember, I've been in the music industry for over 23 years, so, and I'm still here, and I'm 50 years old, so I do feel like I have figured out some things, and it's all about pace. Not letting people push you into a pace that's not yours, and then getting as much sleep and outdoor time as possible, because that, without sleep and outdoor time, it makes us sick. And yeah, those are my advices. Do 2 or 3 and I dream bigger. Pass you with me, with a knife on my back, show me the real scene. Opportunity to be brave together was severed by the cruel words that were delivered. Now I look fire, you gave up some time ago, so I'll turn to the sun, cause she already knows. As my tongue rises, no more surprises, cause we are coming near to the sun. It has begun, so all the sadness is coming in, coming on. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung. We are coming near to the sun. It has begun. Some of the sadness is coming unsung.
What was your life like before and after the Def Jam signing? How did that all go down?
Okay, what was my life before Island Def Jam? Well, I was, my business before that was, I mean, I was trying to get going as a graphic artist, so I was doing like a lot of logo design, silk screening shirts and stuff, but I was also doing prep cooking in restaurants. And then once I signed that deal, I realized that, I mean, it was really cool for me because I realized, I was like, holy shit, like I'm good at this. See, I didn't grow up wanting to play music, so I wasn't like looking for it. But then when it came to me, I was able to see how lucky I was by how people responded to me. So the way people responded to me was, some people were celebratory, but a lot of people got very, very mad, and I lost some friends. And so that was weird to me because, it had two sides where it was like, I realized, oh, I'm really lucky to have this. And also, oh shit, I guess I better get ready because people don't like to see others do well. So it was a very, very, very big wake-up lesson. And but like I say, it was pretty good for me because I was like, oh, I'm good at this. Like, because before that I thought I would get into like food, because I like to prep cook and I like to take care of kitchens and stuff, or care, like elder care, because I like that too. But yeah, that was a huge turn. I went from like working paycheck to paycheck to having a lot of money, and I was able to do a bunch of stuff with it and help my brother. And yeah, I mean, it was such good fortune, and I've had such good fortune since then. But I work really hard. I'm very self-disciplined, and I really value physical fitness and my connection to my family and my community and stuff. It's I feel like without that, those balances, you can't have a career. For me, I don't think I would have a career without that. Oh, feminism and loving women is very important, because women do so much unpaid labor. Like, we are the backbone of most homes. We are organizing, planning, making sure the kids have food, making sure our parents have food, making sure everyone is safe, making sure, like, all of this unpaid work is, it's, when you know that you do it, you see it in other women. And so that's where the loving part comes in. It's like, we all know, I think, as women, how vital our role is in the home and in workplaces and stuff. And so, you know, it's critical. And also, it's like, before the church imposed the structures that are in place where men are like supposedly the leader of a family, many societies knew and continue to know that decisions can't be made without women's consent. Like, at a political level too. So that's why I think feminism is a great lens to look at the world through, because it just acknowledges women's work.
I'm interested to know how you got into making music. What inspired you to shift your focus from visual art to music?
I think I just got cut off, but yeah, I do music. I switched from visual art to music because I was getting paid to do it, and I found I was more prolific in music as an artist than visually. And yeah, I had just a drive in me to write songs and write narrative, and I couldn't do that with just a line on the paper or graffiti and stencil art and everything. It wasn't providing me with enough outlet to push like I wanted to push in terms of narrative. And then obviously I was also like, was able to make good money in it and continue to make good money in it. And so I'm very grateful for that. And I love creating music.
Your work deals with a wide variety of issues, including race, gender, and humanity. How has your work developed throughout your career, and have your interests changed?
Okay, the question is, have my interests changed? Like, I write about the same things quite a lot. Sadly, I don't think my interests have changed. I've heard it said too that a lot of writers will write the same book through their whole life. Stephen King said that. He said he's been writing the same book his whole life. And I sort of feel that way about the things that I'm interested in. I really apologize to my listeners, because I tend to write the same shit over and over. But I'm hoping I will get a lot better at it by the time I am older. Are you happy? Are you satisfied? How long can you stand a heat? Out of the doorway, the bullets rip now to the sound of the beat. Look out. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, boom.
stating that the reception of your work is affected by the fact that you are a Native artist. Have you ever felt that your heritage put you at a disadvantage compared to other artists in the industry?
Okay, I've given myself a headrest now, the wall. I do think that the reception to an artist, if the person knows that they're Indigenous, there's going to be a different response. And even though from a public, from a media perspective, people will be like, oh yeah, well, so-and-so, they're just doing well because they're Native. That's like because there's a lot of promotion of indigeneity in the media, but that doesn't mean that actually your life is improved by being Indigenous in the arts. I'll give you an example. When I first entered the industry, I never talked about being Native because in my family, well, because we're mixed and we're white too, and you know, my dad was always like, you never tell people you're Indian, like, fuck. And so when I entered the industry, I never talked about it, and then a few years in, because at festivals, Native people would be coming up to me and being like, hey, Indian girl, like, why aren't you proud of being Indian? And so I was like, yeah, actually I should put it in that I'm part Mohawk. And then I went from playing like Friday nights at festivals at 9 p.m. on the main stage to like Sundays at 10 a.m. at the kids' tent so it's like my career actually took a total dive. That was in 2004. I released Sun Again and my career was like going up, 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 up. And then it was like I talked about being part Mohawk and it was like down, 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 down. I mean, I'm still happy with where I'm at and I love my work and everything, but I honestly think that that was not the best idea. And I remember my dad saying to me too, he was like, you never tell people that you're part Native if you can pass for white. So, yeah, I don't know how long it's going to be cool in the media to be Native, but I know that at a grassroots level, we still, like, it's still better if people think you're white.
Are there any artists that influenced your own art practice?
Okay, I'm copping out and using this deadly filter for this last question. For this question, there might be one more coming, I think. Are there artists that have influenced my art practice? Yeah, I mean, well, for one thing, Fritz Scholder, like his paintings, like his like fancy dancer paintings with like, I think it's like Pepsi cans, and his whole Indian Not Indian show, and Bill Reed has influenced me tremendously because he was his mom tried to get him to not know that she didn't want the kids to know that they were Native, so she moved them to Victoria, BC, and he didn't actually really figure out that he was part Native until his 30s. And then also he never really referred to himself as Haida in the first person. So that's very interesting to me too, because I've seen that in members of my own family where like my dad will often talk about the Indians instead of like talking about being Native. And I think that that's like a thing that you see in mixed blood people. And I really am very inspired by that like lucidity and that kind of ability to just be in a liminal space. I know it's a privilege, obviously, to kind of move between ethnicities, and obviously some people call bullshit on it, and they're like, ah, if you don't, you're either Native or you're white, and that's one way of looking at it too. But I really appreciate artists who kind of walk like the line between spaces. Another super inspiring artist for me was Kim Gordon from Sonic Youth, for the same reasons. Like, she kind of like inhabited her own space, And then Edna St. Vincent Millay, her poetry and her, she's very ambiguous between, like, between.
What is the role of the artist in society? And do you think that art can promote social change?
Okay, so the question is, what is our job as artists? What or what role do artists play? I think that we play, I like to say that art is, it's like a, when basic and simple things are put together in a way that has, evokes an emotional response in the listener or the viewer. So for example, like Fritz Schulder, like he's, in my opinion, he's just, he's my favorite painter. And when I look at his work, I am completely transported and I feel like very powerful when I look at his work. So that's the kind of thing like that I like to think that I aspire to as an artist, where I like to create content that is going to put a fire under people's ass, make them feel beautiful or strong or hopeful, sexy, vibrant, all rebellious. So yeah, that's what I think our role is. And I try and stay most, for the most, like I left Facebook and Twitter in the last couple of years. My label runs my Facebook page, but I don't look at those sites anymore. I still look at Instagram, but in general, I try and keep my mind pretty clean. I don't download a lot of music. I don't listen to a lot of music. I try not to be influenced by other artists. Of course I am, just by virtue of being in society, but I try not to imitate. I just try to like create content, and I feel like that's my job. I get paid for it, I like doing it, and the harder I work at it, the better I'm gonna be at it, and then I'm gonna be able to make things that make people feel great.
Look, the skinny star thing you got going, it ain't gonna work. You gotta choose a fucking style. You can't just be like, one day doing rap, one day doing punk, one day some kind of fucking native thing, the next day you fucking folk, you're the white girl, the next day you fucking rocking out with some poetry. This ain't gonna work.
Star has also recently created subversive social media performance art featuring her manager, James LaDouche.
James LaDouche, I'm calling the art police right now on Kenny Star, right now. Here I go.
This question is for James LaDouche. Why is being a shaman important?
Great question. Why is being a shaman important? Thanks for asking that. Look, I'm a businessman, okay? So everything I do is revolving around making money, making inroads, going to the golf course, getting my hair done, and then mostly just helping people out by telling them what is right and wrong according to me, which is always right because I am a businessman. So listen, why is being a shaman important? The very fact you have to ask me that shows that you don't understand anything about shamanism. Okay, I've been to 2 weekend courses now. I got my level 2.13. What do you think that means? If you don't know, you don't know. Okay?
How should women be treated in the music industry?
You ask me how should women be treated in the music industry, for Christ's sake. What kind of a question is that? Look, business is hard for everyone, okay? Business isn't just hard for women. Business is hard for people like me, too. That's why when I get to the office, I expect the ladies are looking good with all the stuff on, you know, the clothing that sucks them in, so I get a little bit of a charge when I see their ass walking by. Does that make me a bad person? I don't think so. Look, you shouldn't fix something that isn't broken, okay? And people like Kenny Starr, they go on and on, make their stupid little films about gender and equity and so on and so forth. Who cares? I don't. I don't, as long as the bitches look great, they're willing to do a lot of the ass shots and stuff and get me my drinks, suck my dick here and there, I don't really, doesn't matter to me. Don't fix what ain't broken.
How did you and Star meet?
These questions are really getting on my nerves. Okay, I've got some important things to attend to, so this is going to be towards the end of my interview here, for fuck's sake. So, how did I meet Kinney Starr? I mean, how everyone meets Kinney Starr. By seeing her at the strip club. You know, Kinney Starr presents herself as some kind of as, you know, feminist here and there, this and that, whatever. Blah, blah, I like women, I think they're great. And then, you know, then she goes to the strip club. Like, what kind of a feminist is that? So that's where I first saw her. She was doing some amateur pole dancing, and I thought, wow, great hip-to-waist ratio. I can make some money off of that. I was in Gatineau at the time with some of my cousins. Gatineau has some great strip clubs, if you know what I mean. Yeah, so that's where I met Kinney Starr.
Unadjusted, the down that man's hip. B-boy took on his head and he didn't need no fashion tipping. 60-year-old woman setting out to be raving. Hair in short pigtails, wearing stripes like girls be craving.
What is best in life?
Glad you asked me that question, what is best in life? It's a great question. I'll tell you what's best in life for me. For me, what is best in life is having good frosting, making a trip to the golf course, getting my glasses shined, my shoes shined, and my kirok shined. That's what I like. Also like facials, manicures. I like Justin Trudeau a lot. We have a very special private relationship, and Drake and I are quite close as well, so go figure.
What does the future hold for an artist like Kinney Starr?
James LaRouche here. Thanks a lot for interviewing me and supporting my brand, shamanism.com, 2.13. So, what does the future hold for Kinney Starr? Look, I'm a businessman. I see no future for her. You know, she hasn't become famous, like, by now, like, you know, billboards on buildings, and why bother trying, is what I say. Who cares about making the world a better place if you're not going to become super, super famous? Why bother trying? So I don't see anything changing for her, any of her, you know, sort of art, pagan, witchy, Indian, rocker, metalhead type of glassblower weirdo friends. Those guys have got to get real jobs. Her and all her friends.
I mean, I just love talking about myself all the time.
So feel free to look upon me as what you see. I'm fairness in the winter, brown like summer's father. All my blood knows that the earth is a mother. I wake some nights to see the moon ache with wonder at family truths been buried stale under.